Hello, welcome to Elemental Film Festival in full color. I'm Rajbir Singh and I will be presenting with this film festival with
Ezra Duke
and this one I've promoted.
We are starting with a short film called Are You Okay? This film is about caring about the people around you and how easy it actually is. Here we present you, Are You Okay?
Wikipedia states that the French started in 1789. Okay, I'm back with Mr. Napoleon. Anyways, let's move on to, well, if you want to learn more about history, we can just talk about Game of Thrones. Amazing TV show, recommend to watch it in class, yes, on campus, instead of doing many other more productive things. Yeah, and let's talk about the elections. Like, whew, I really thought Trump was going to win. He deserved all of that.
Okay, so
back. Our next film is called Control, that is made by SAE student Helena. It's a film called Control that is about how social media can control your mind and how it actually controls your daily life as well. Here we present you Control.
Hey.
Welcome back, everyone. Now we will be having a short Q&A of mental health that you can ask me, and I will be answering them. And I will also be talking about my personal experience when we're talking about social media. So for me, social media is something where I share my art and the way I make my films. And now, especially with COVID coming up as well, it was quite difficult to do that because there were, of course, you can't meet everyone that you want to meet, so it's quite difficult to do that. And I felt that all the things that I had planned were cancelled, so I felt quite pressured, like, oh, my audience that I have just thinks, oh, he's done. He doesn't have anything to do anymore. So it was quite difficult for me. And especially with school as well, we had, like, everything was online, so we couldn't meet each other up. All the students that were supposed to do work together couldn't meet up. So it was even more difficult then. And I think that is quite difficult for everyone. Every artist probably in COVID, it could have gone both ways. It could have been positive, could have been negative. I've heard a lot of negative stuff as well, like people, mental health issues went up a lot during COVID. And some people also, because they have time to spend with their family, had a great time because they could spend more time with their kids, their wife, or any family member that they have. So that's one part that I always see when it comes to mental health that can also be positive sometimes if you have the right people around you, but can also be negative if you're all alone. And especially with social media then, you see a lot of things that being perfect is one thing. You always have to be perfect on Instagram, always have a smile. You can't show the negative parts. That's standard issues that you have. But it's also, now I see coming up more that also the negativities are like body positivity is being talked about a lot now. So that's one part that is really nice. And so now we will be introducing you the next film, People in Color. This is a film about a young boy who's in his teenage times and he doesn't really like his father until he gets a camera from his father and he starts taking pictures of people and like starts appreciating more the people around him and also his father. So that's how it changes his life and changes his relationship as well. So here we give you People in Color.
My dad's weird. He's also constantly checking to see if I'm okay, which is pointless and starting to get on my nerves. He bought me a camera though, so I've decided to become a photographer.
Nah, man, you see me triathlon just because I fucked up my ankle.
Nah, mate, the only reason you fucked up is because Rachel was here.
Shut up, you lanky shit. We all know your knees get weak when Kira's around.
Nah, man.
Stop being such a pussy, man. Show who's the man.
What do you think you're doing? You creep! Why are you taking photos of me?
I'm sorry.
Wait!
Your attention, please. The train to...
known as a prophet, the 70s find me. So we were crazy in the 80s, we were just better tell me the truth, Mike.
Listen, Al, you've got to stop listening to what the girls say about me. You know that they don't like me.
Why should I believe that? Aisha told me specifically that you walked Millie home when you told me that you were at practice.
Yeah, and what's wrong with that? I was just walking her home.
Jesus Christ, Mike. I cannot believe you. I'm done.
Al, come back here.
Is everything okay?
Yes, Dad, everything's fine. Now, can you please stop asking me the same question over and over again?
Yeah, okay, okay.
Excuse me?
Yes?
Would you mind opening this?
Here you go.
Thanks.
Wait, wait, wait.
Yeah?
Do you mind if we take a picture together?
Sure.
Don't say anything, just hear me out. I've always had a fascination with strangers. I like the concept of getting glimpses into all of these undiscovered lives. This might be why people watching is such a popular sport. I never have the courage to speak to these strangers, though. When you think about it, the possibility of it all is so endless. It's like every glimpse of a new face hides its own story, and we are only privileged enough to get a small insight left wondering over all of these missed opportunities.
Listen to the audio in the background, you could hear that really well. And for the rest, we really try to put emphasis on actually caring about the people, even if you have to have that 1.5 meter distance, like they were giving letters out to each other. That's one way of doing it, of course. I have another question here. How long did it take to film everything? I would say most films are probably filmed in a day, because they're mostly film assignments, you could say. And are you okay with filmed in like 2 hours because surprisingly it was just a break. That's why it's also a 1 minute film. How did you come up with the idea of making this festival? We came up with it actually just being in COVID. We felt like, oh, we need the attention to give attention around the to the people around us and really feel like, oh, we actually care about the people around us, and we know how difficult it can be on your mental health of maybe being alone and having everything online is quite difficult. You don't have the affection of people around you. So that's why we did this live stream, because most of the film festivals, as SAE has done before, were all live. So that's why you didn't want to cancel it this year. So that's why this live stream and this vibe that we have around us of just having a normal talk with, of course, following the rules of COVID and giving attention to mental health. Now we will be having an interview with Cynthia Taylor. Here you have the interview. Hi, Cynthia Taylor. How are you?
Hello, Rasveer. I'm fine, thank you.
That's nice. Who is Cynthia Taylor? Tell us more about yourself.
Who am I?
What does she do as a daily?
Yeah, well, I'm a writer and director for both film and theater. I started out as a journalist, and then I shifted towards fiction. And then I find the best ways, the best mediums to tell a story.
From where did you get the thought to make a movie about depression then?
Well, it's a very personal topic to me because I've actually suffered from depression my whole life. And it's me as a maker, I always want to talk about matters that sometimes are a bit taboos or they're not talked about enough or are difficult to confront. And so this was one of them. Because we didn't have much time to really think of a story we had about 2 weeks to prepare everything, what I did was to go back to some poems I had. I said, okay, let's go with an experimental film. And I just looked for some poems that I had, and I had written a version of this monologue as a poem before. And I think it's something, depression is still something that people have a hard time talking about. There's still a lot of shame surrounding depression. And I wanted to put it out there, basically.
Now then, talking about for upcoming work, do you think you will work with mental health more then?
I'm also a maker. Like my stories are very much inner driven. It's really much about an inner struggle. And so, per se, that touches upon emotional stability and mental health. But some are just, lighter variations of it. And this one is really, it is what it is. It really is about depression. So I think I will address more, but different lights. I've said this one, so I now want to address it differently. I don't have a concrete plan now. If you're going to ask me about that, I don't have a concrete plan yet. but yes, I think I will definitely touch upon it. Also, because again, it's part of who we are as human, right? And we talk about diseases so much, but mental health, we don't see it as in a serious manner as we must. But mental health actually affects physical health. And people don't think about it, So if you tackle mental health, you are also tackling some aspects of physical health.
Yeah.
And I think we just don't give the right importance to mental health in our society. We're supposed to be strong, and we're supposed to go through it all. We need to man up, or we need to just get over it, right? And I just want to confront it head on. Like, okay, why should we? So yes, I will definitely, and because also my films are very female centric, they are female centric, and I'm really interested in the emotional side of women, and partly because I feel that we are misrepresented a lot in films. It's a lot with a male gaze, and usually women, are shown in these crazy light, you know. You have, when you talk about mental health of women, usually they're having a meltdown, they go crazy, they take on revenge, and they become murderers, or they want to ruin someone's life. And in real life, that's not the case, actually. But because women are taught in a lot of societies, in a lot of cultures, women are taught to just, you know, swallow their emotions and just, you know, move on, and just you're there to be, you know, the mother. You're there to take on all this emotional charge on your shoulders, and that's very hard and something that's not really addressed, I think, in films enough.
Why do you then think of like storytelling being so important with mental health? What do you think is the connection between them, and why we should keep that connection on?
Well, it has to do with the reason why we tell stories and why we watch and listen to stories. And I think the reason for that is just because we want to understand a bit our humanity. We want to understand exactly what's the point in life and universe and all of that. And so I think film in particular is an extremely powerful medium to get stories across, to get, you know, ideas across. We are exposed to different worlds, to different perspectives through film, fiction based on reality, of course. But we also think about what films can bring us. For example, think about Brokeback Mountain or Moonlight, how they challenge our perceptions on homosexuality and male vulnerability.
Welcome back, everyone. It was really nice to talk with Cynthia. She said she was sorry that she couldn't be here, but we still did a recorded one, so that's really nice. And now we will present you If Only Nothingness Was a Thing.
You think you know, but you don't understand. The darkness kisses us good morning, and the sun tells us lies. It never rises. It never shines. Our feet are cold. Our heart is frozen. It doesn't beat or accelerate when dawn rises once again. You think you understand, but you don't know. The vacuum. The empty carcass. And the void. The void. Oh, the void that devours the last sparkle of our soul. I'm so cold. I'm so cold. There may be 1,000 blankets, but none will keep us warm. Grey becomes the only rainbow we know, and water the only wish, the only longing, and the hope that one day we can drown, and it will all be over. If only nothingness was a thing.
Welcome back, everyone. Now, we will be showing you the trailer of Clinch, Cynthia Taylor's last film, a post-Me Too film, the first actually post-Me Too film of the Netherlands. It was quite a film. Here you have the trailer. Welcome back. Now we will be having an interview with Cynthia Taylor about the film, how she made it, and where she got that idea from. Here you have the interview.
So now talking about the Clinch, what drew you to write a post-Me Too story?
It didn't start out as a post-me story. That was something that the film grant called it, and we thought, oh, it's interesting to look at it that way. But I get images and ideas every day, and this one stuck with me. I just saw this woman training, in a manner of life and death, and I was trying to understand, okay, why is she training so hard? What is so urgent about this practice? And I just started exploring the character, and I came to a sort of topic of revenge, but revenge for what? I wasn't sure. And then somehow, one or another way, the whole theme of sexual violence came to me, but I still didn't have enough of, a defining factor that would make this film different. And then the whole Me Too movement happened, and then it clicked to me because I was listening or reading actually to all these women who had been victim of sexual harassment, sexual violence, and what struck me the most was how they all followed a certain pattern of shame and guilt and pain. Yeah. And some of these women were quite powerful, and still they could not address it. And so I started exploring that, but I was more interested in not exploring the pain itself, but how do you get out of that? And again, connecting with depression, me suffering from depression, I mean, when you hit that bottom, it's so hard to rise again. And so I was interested in exploring what would be the journey of a woman who had been violated, how could she, you know, find her way back to herself again? And through my research, I spoke to a lot of experts on this. I decided not to speak to victims with the reason that every story is super personal and everyone acts differently. And I was interested in looking at patterns of behavior. And the experts could give me those patterns. And so when I spoke to the experts, one expert, Anouk Davens from Centre Sexueel Geweld, she told me the hardest thing for these women is to accept that this incident is now part of their life story.
As you being the first person who made a post-Me Too movie in the Netherlands, do you think that like people that deal with this issue, do they have enough help here in the Netherlands? Like you already said, you had you did research for the film. When you talk to them, do you think, oh, it's easy to go to them, or it's like, no, I don't want to talk to them?
Right. Yeah. Depends on which part of the journey they're at. It's very hard for victims to go to the police. I'm in close touch with an activist who shared with me a lot of stories that I was really shocked about the way how the police has dealt with these stories, where women would go to press charges against the men, and they were told, "Are you really sure? Because you're going to ruin his life." When in fact it's the life of the victim that should be protected. And so there you a lot of women will find hurdles. Then you have organizations that provide support for victims, but they don't do, you know, the criminal charges. And there's a lot of help and support. But it's also interesting to know that it's not always beneficial for women to seek help and support. Because again, each person is different and we deal with events in our life in different ways. So yeah, we might think, oh, you know, if you've been a victim of sexual violence, you need to go and talk to someone. No, that doesn't work with every single woman, because that could actually make it worse for their mental health. So each woman is different. They might be ready, you know, to address the issue within the day, or they might be ready to address it in 10 years, or they might never be ready to talk about it. And it does not mean that they will not heal from it. It does not mean that they will not be able to, you know, continue living their life. Each person is different, and we cannot judge on the way they react. So yes, I think there's a lot of work still to be done at police level. I think there's a lot of sensibility work to be done there. I think we need to remove a lot of sexist layers from the police. But then there are indeed other organizations which are easier to reach and which provide full support to these women. And, you know, like we influence each other, we inspire each other as filmmakers, right? So maybe there will be other films that, that after watching our film, there'll be other writers and other directors who might want to address these topics as well and bring other perspectives and viewpoints to the conversation. Because, of course, this is just one. This is just my perspective on overcoming sexual violence. It's not the only one. So, we were very proud, and we hope that this will indeed bring in more films about overcoming sexual violence.
Did you feel like, of course you released the film on a live stream in COVID times? Mm-hmm. Did you think like if COVID wasn't here, your film maybe would have gone bigger than you thought, like exposure wise?
Well, you never know. But we had to basically have limited online releases because I've been granted a fund, and a condition was that some people would watch it in Amsterdam. Amsterdamers would watch it. And so I had to release it now for a limited time, and I might release it then again next year for a limited time. But it is true that it does affect, you know, like, cinemas to be watched in a film theater, right? So
yeah,
the moment you watch it online, it's already different. I mean, how many films have you watched in the cinema and you were like, wow, and then you watch them again at home, you know, on the smaller screen, and it doesn't have the same impact. Yeah. So yes, it does. It might have impacted that in that sense, the number of people who would come and watch it, because if it would be, you know, if I would have released it on a theater, there's a whole experience. Then there's the thing about online streaming that we are just used to watch it whenever we want, you know, we just click on it. And, yeah, we watch it. But because I'm sending it to festivals, there is also a limit in the amount of hours that the film can be online. So I cannot just leave it on demand. I need to just stream it live for, you know, limited time. And that also affects, because people just have other things to do at that time of the day and they forget about it. And so,
yes,
those things do affect the film. Whether I would have gotten more views, more visibility if it were in a physical theater, well, I cannot speculate on that. I don't know.
Were you then actually, now that you're talking about this, were you happy with getting the funds? Because you yourself said, oh, I had these minus points that I can't release it when I want to, I have to wait. Do you think that was a pressure upon you?
Yeah, I mean, there's always that, those conditions, you know, every fund comes with a certain with certain number of conditions, which I fully understand. But we needed funding for the film. Filmmaking is a very expensive medium, and still everyone worked for free. So it was really for expenses. And but yeah, I mean, yeah, you always have this. And oh, and we also had a delay because people were working for free. It had to be done only, you know, in the free time. Yeah. So we had a big delay in the post-production of about almost a year. So we released the film a year later than was supposed to have been released. So that put a bit of pressure indeed in terms of screenings, because the idea initially was to first send it to festivals and then would still have, you know, half a year or so to show it to locals in whatever manner. But we now missed that train. So we're trying to just, you know, combine the two in one way or the other.
Will there still be a cinema release, or do you think?
I hope so. Well, I hope so. I don't know. Well, it's very hard for short films to have a proper cinema release. And then if they are very short, they sometimes can be shown before a feature film in the cinema. But this one is 25 minutes. So, that takes already quite a big chunk of the slot that a cinema theater has, that a cinema has for a feature film. So the likelihood of it being shown per se just in the theater with other features or something, it's very small. I mean, depends on how things go. We might also have, you know, we might self-organize ourselves and just show it also in cinemas with, you know, as part of a larger event or something. I'm not sure yet.
Well, we hope to see it in the cinema. I still have to watch it myself. Even I forgot, like, oh, it's on the live stream. I forgot that as well. But I hope to see it soon. Thank you, Cynthia Taylor, for talking to us. Have a nice day.
Thank you so much for having me.
Hi. So, I want to learn how to fight.
Uh-huh.
Like throwing some punches and kick people and, you know, beat them.
Kick people and beat them? All right.
I saw you earlier with this girl, and I would like you to teach me.
Hmm. Why? Who are you fighting?
Forget it.
Tomorrow at 9.
8.
All right, slowly now, okay? Stay where you are. Good. So from here, a couple of things we can do. Either a block, or I go on the outside, in this position, grab the wrist, throw a punch, or... Good. A couple of things you can do to get out of here. Well, that's one way, I suppose. Come with the left. Good. Relax, okay? Slowly, as before, and I'll show you how it's done. Uh-huh. Good. So now, block on the outside. Take hold of the arm. Go around. Good. So this happens often, okay? We really need to know how to get out of
Welcome back, everyone. I see that I've got some questions here. Please, if you want to ask anything about the festival or about this topic even, please keep on sending us questions. We would love to answer them. The first question that we have is, did you feel comfortable talking about this topic? Me, myself, talking about mental health for me is like quite normal, also because I maybe do it at home as well. We're quite open at our house, so I think for me it's comfortable, yeah. But I get why people sometimes get uncomfortable, because it's quite personal. You're letting actually someone into your brain, you could say, with talking so personally. The next question that we have is, how was interviewing Cynthia? Interviewing Cynthia was quite interesting, especially because we had lessons with her as well. So it's quite a different talk that you have with a teacher and just a human being as well, as an artist. So now I spoke to her as an artist, it's quite a different look that you have, of course, than a teacher and a filmmaker. She has a lot of experience, theater, writing, and then, of course, making films as well. So she's definitely going the good way. And I have another comment. It says, you have amazing image. I'm sure the cameras are not Sony. Yes, you're totally right. We are only using Blackmagic cameras, so that you know, Blackmagic. And we have another comment. It's really interesting that someone is sharing and talking about how movies can change perspectives of people. How we get our ideas and morals from the media. That's so true. Media is such a powerful thing now. It goes both ways. You can see horrible things happening on media, like bullying or even like putting people down. But at the other side, you also see that positivity coming up as well. How are you doing this time? Is it hard to be a filmmaker now? I would say for some people around me, I really feel like, oh, they're having difficulties. Like, I'm just giving an example, you're a cameraman, then you're having difficulties. But me personally, I like writing and directing. So the directing part now is paused, and then I'm focusing upon writing. So I try to keep it both in balance now. It's just trying to replace what you're doing. So that's how I'm working at the moment. What was your favorite part of organizing such an event? I would say when you get the idea and then bring it into your plan and that plan actually works. I think the whole process of that is just amazing to see. Such a small idea, just talking about it randomly in a classroom. Oh, like, let's do a live stream. Then you're thinking like, oh, okay, we'll be able to do that. We'll work. So we actually feel that we have accomplished something right. So that part really gives me a boost. What do you think is the biggest disadvantage and biggest advantage for film during this pandemic? I would say binge watching every series that you have. I've watched like every series that was like between March and April. Some series actually came earlier because they actually wanted to give their audiences a favor, like, oh, there were some Dutch series as well that came earlier on Videoland, on those kind of streaming sites. So that's really interesting. You got the time for it, and you can enjoy it without having any stress, like, oh, I have to go to school tomorrow. Yeah, maybe you do have to go to school, but it's still online, so you still have that extra half an hour maybe. How can we make an impact on social media? I would say everyone can make an impact on social media, and how you can do that is all dependent upon you. As I see often now that people are trying to become like others, like, I'm just giving an example. I don't have to become like Tess because there's already one Tess there. So why don't I become like myself so that the world has something of me extra? So that's what I would advise to all of you then. Be like yourself and just post what you like. If you like posting dog filters with you in a photo, do that. Great. If you feel good in that, please do that. If you like to go to the gym and you'd like to post your workout video, just do it. You don't have to ask any permission from anyone. Just your way of life. If somebody likes it, they'll follow you. If they don't like it, you won't follow them. Or the other way around. So just be yourself, I would say, and that's the most important part. And of course there will be people that will put you down, but that happens in daily life as well. But the only thing is, with these messages, they only show to you, and when it's in personal life, maybe there can be a person standing next to you as well. The next question that I have is, how hard was it to work with a crew on your own projects? Are there any ego issues as well? How hard it is, I would say it's just getting everyone on the same page. Of course, everyone has a different idea, but when it's the best when you can combine them all together, I find. So ego issues there can be like, oh, I want to do this, I'm the best at this, I'm the best at that. Sure, but at the end of the day, when it comes to being artistic and being a filmmaker, if you are best in something, it's better to help someone else with it as well then, I find. Do you have any advice on treating someone who's suffering from mental health? I get that that question is quite difficult for some, maybe. I think talking to people will be your best thing to do. And always, when I say people, can be an expert on it, or it can be even your mom. Someone who can just listen. Like, I know people. Let's say I even felt better when I bought a dog and I could go on a walk with him every day. Because at the end of the day, it's a living being, a dog. So you could still, some people talk to their dogs as well. So I would say just talk to someone. At the end of the day, that's the best way you can do it. And if you think, no, I just don't want to talk about some to someone or anything like that, or Maybe you should just try to read a book that you like or that talks about that topic. Watch a film that talks about a topic. You can also take it in an artistic way as well, yeah. The next, on your social media, I saw that you were protesting something. Could you tell me what's going on? Yes, I can. That's quite personal. It's actually a farming bill that the Indian government has put upon farmers in India. It's I call it the three black farming bills that they released during COVID. And farmers are protesting now in Delhi. They're live, like a million trucks, a million people there standing in front of Delhi and telling the government that please don't put this on us. They're still peacefully talking to them, and this protest is going worldwide now. I will give you also some advice that if you eat food, you should also know, like, oh, without farmers, there will be no food. And a lot of food that even we get in Europe comes from India. Spices, canned food can come from India as well. So these things, I would say, of course, these so-called big corporations, they want the best for you, but at the end of the day, they won't be doing the best for farmers. So that's what it's mostly about. Should we expect the festival again next year? I think you can expect a festival again next year, yeah. But I don't know if there will be a live stream or if it will be live in person. I hope that it's live in person so that you have more of a connection with each other. But even a live stream, we could still be together digitally. So I hope so. If there's one film that inspired you for your mental health issues in the past or inspired you, I will talk about one film that I watched a few days ago. It was called Wonder. It's about a child who has, he has some kind of, he has something with his face from birth, so that kind of changes him from the rest, but it just shows his journey from a small age to like high school and how he deals with it and how people treat him and how he treats those people that do badly with him. So I find me as a Sikh, I look different here in the Netherlands. Everywhere I go, high school, uni, I was always the first. So I kind of felt that same vibe from him. So that was quite interesting for me. Okay. Now we'll have a small break and then we'll come back to you with another film. Thank you.
We'll be right back. as you know at the beginning of the film. My name is Ezra Luke. Next on the program is going to be the short film One Step. It's written by Dune Fitzgerald. I met Dune at, ironically, his film festival, which was the D&D film festival that was last year, if I recall correctly. He is an American who lives in the Netherlands, and he has for a long time. He likes to write short comedy skits that you can see on YouTube, and that's really his inspiration when he writes a script or like makes a movie or how he directs. One Step is a sort of, it started out as a dark humor short. That's how Dune wrote it, in any case. As well as that, when he wrote it, he, of course, saw many short skits on YouTube that were taken as inspiration to him. One Step is about a girl who's trapped inside her house because she's scared of the outside world. Some of you may relate to it, some of you won't, or some of you may learn from it. But in any case, I hope that it inspires you to handle a person that's suffering from that sort of issue in the future. And as I said in the beginning, it started out as a dark humor skit, but obviously that's not how it's going to be portrayed when we show it next. I hope that you enjoy the short film, One Step, by Dune Fitzgerald.
This is a penguin, a creature whose life is full of wonder and cruelty. Many of these beautiful creatures live most of their lives in captivity, unable to truly chase their dreams. Once these creatures have spent a prolonged time in captivity, they become accustomed to this way of living and become unable to function in the wild. Sometimes they even grow an acute fear of the world outside their small and safe enclosure. Penguins have a similar sense of family and friends to us humans. They get lonely when separated and will feel a slight heartache. This has been your daily dose of Netflix. Don't dream, keep watching. Jumping and to the sea, the penguin gets hit by a wave of cold water. He has made his first step into hunting for today's catch. Of family and friends to us humans. They get lonely when separated and will feel a slight heartache. Once a penguin becomes accustomed to its enclosure, it almost never feels the need to leave. But in some rare cases, the penguin's curiosity gets the better of him. Dark waters are always the scariest for penguins to swim in. Who knows what sort of predators or dangers lie in wait for the small, curious penguin. The penguin won't be discouraged by yesterday's failure. He is prepared to face dangerous waters once again, and face the many threats that await him. But watch out, because behind every corner lies hidden dangers.
One step. One step. One step. One step. One step. One step.
Even if life outside of an enclosure is dangerous for a penguin, he continues to embrace those dangers. He waddles his one way step. Into this big and unsure world with no guarantee of safety. Don't they?
Welcome back. I hope you enjoyed the short. I want to mention that this short was made by SAE students. Of course, SAE being our sponsor as well. I saw a few posts on their Instagram page about us, so thank you, SAE. Please check them out if you have time after the stream. What I also wanted to say is you can all, of course, you can watch this stream after it's been published, after we're done. It's saved on Twitch, so you can just come to this account and rewatch the whole stream. Next, we're going to have an interview with Peter Fruman. He is one of the owners of Storybags. You can already prepare your questions because we're also doing a Q&A with you, with Peter, if that makes sense. Peter, welcome on the show.
Thank you for having me.
Can you please tell us a bit about yourself?
About myself? Well, I came to the Netherlands from Austria, and so I'm Dutch now, and I have my past is art school, fine arts, and then advertising. I have studied psychology as well, and at a certain time, I've worked in advertising agencies as an art director and copywriter, and later as creative director at my own agency. Mm-hmm. And at a certain point in time, in a way, not only because of my profession as an advertising guy, I started to become interested more in storytelling. And that happened when I went to a storytelling festival mm-hmm. for the first time after a very, very, very long time. And in a way, I rediscovered storytelling as not only as a one-way storytelling, but also as a dialogue between the teller and the listener.
Yeah.
And after that, I tried to implement this into my work, as also like listening to your organization, listening to other people's stories, their desires, their needs, and so on, also in organizations, and get this dialogue going between management and organization. And that's also when I started to develop workshops and trainings. And through that, I got into the European educational affairs from the European Commission, the education programs, where I developed more trainings, and then also started to lecture on storytelling.
You said that you got inspired by Storytelling Film Festival.
Storytelling Festival.
Yes. Was it mainly master classes? Did you do anything yourself?
Not at that time. The first time, it was just seeing a professional storyteller getting the audience engaged in right. the story, which fascinated me because we were there with 50 people, and he started to tell something about himself, and then gradually, suddenly, we were in the story. And when you looked at the other people of the audience, you saw, you know, this the thumb in the mouth thing, like little children do when they hear a story, completely engaged in the story. And what I also recognized was that when he was telling the story, I was also engaged, of course. But when he was telling the story, he sometimes asked questions to the audience, like, can you follow me? Am I going too fast? Okay, am I going too quick? And then he tried to, sometimes he wandered off the story to a side story in a way, and then he stopped and said, oh, where was I? So the audience could tell him you were there in that story. So there was this really, this nice dialogue going on. And that fascinated me, because I never looked at it that way. It was a kind of a revelation, yeah? And after that, I contacted him, and we got into talking, and that took years, because I learned a lot of him, and also from other storytellers. And then I started, of course, going to workshops by storytellers, and how they taught me to look at stories in a different way, and in a much more diverse way than you would expect. Like, storytelling is a fairy tale, and that's it.
Yeah. Do you have any favorite stories or stories that inspire you when you're telling a story or like writing a story?
Well, I'm not a professional storyteller.
No.
I don't want to think of myself as a professional storyteller. And of course, I have favorite stories from my youth, my childhood, or my youth later on. When I love the Greek epics, for instance, like Battle of Troy and Odysseus and all these old stories, and they really fascinated me.
So it's more the heroics that inspire
you? Well, the epics, but also, I mean, some other stories, like, you know, I don't know if you know it, Nils Holgersson, for instance.
I might have heard of it. Could you?
It's a Swedish story, and it's an interesting story in many ways, because the author, Selma Lagerlöf, she was also a historian and a storyteller and writer. And she was asked by the Swedish government to write a book about the geographic history of Sweden, history and also the geography of Sweden. And so she had to find a kind of a hook, how she could tell it. And then she thought of the story of this little boy on a farm who liked to bully animals. And there were also gnomes on the farm as well. And one day he saw a gnome, and he tried to bully the gnome as well. And then he got cursed by the gnomes, the dwarfs. And he became a very small, like the gnomes, very small guy. And on a certain day, wild geese came flying over, and he saw that one of the geese, called Martin, wanted to fly with him from the farm, just a farm goose. And so he jumped on the back of the goose when he started to follow the geese. And then this tame goose joined the wild geese in their journey up to the north of Sweden with this little guy on the back of the goose. This is how she tells a story of a young boy coming of age, because it's a kind of coming of age story as well, because he realizes that animals and nature and everything is very, very important. On the other hand, she showed from the point of view of the geese how Sweden came to be, and all these legends of Sweden, of the landscapes and the provinces of Sweden came to be. So this is really a nice combination of learning a lot about the history, the legends, geography of Sweden through a story. So this, I still think it's one of the best stories about a country.
Well, talking about those kind of stories, you are, of course, the owner of Storybags. Could you maybe tell us about what it is, what you do?
Yeah, well, right now, let's say I started with Storybag when I tried to stop my advertising agency, which I had, and I started Storybag to help organizations with their stories. You know, there are corporate stories, and often corporate stories are imagined stories, purely for the image. This is what we want to be. This is what we would look like, want to look like to the outside. But it's very seldom based on the real culture of the organization. So what I tried to do with organizations, have listened to the organization, how people experience the organization, and how they experience the values of the organization, if you have formulated values about the organization. So like integrity. So almost never you see when there's a value, let's say, it's not really underpinned by real events, so to say. So when you ask the organization, what is your experience of integrity? Can you tell me a moment when you saw integrity in the organization, or you yourself showed integrity? Can you tell me about it? Then you get a story from a person. Remember the moment, what happened before? What did you do? What did the other do? What did change? And what happened then? And did it turn out well for the organization or the client? And then you have a story, and then there's content to a value. A value can be filled with stories. And that's what you can show to your clients. If a client asks you tell me about your value. Then you feel, oh yeah, I have this story and that story. I can prove it.
As I was your student before, because you taught me, and I was really inspired by your lessons and really put things into perspective. I was wondering, and also because I felt that when I attended your lessons, I felt a bit, I felt a bit blocked because I also didn't want to get too personal. Have you had any issues with people or youngsters that had any trouble telling their story or of any kind?
I think it's very often, if you ask people, tell me a story, they will say, I have no stories. And I don't know how to tell stories. And so that's the wrong question in a way, because you're asking somebody to be something that he thinks he isn't. But when I ask you, can you think of a moment when you were really happy? That's a completely different thing. You are really sad, doesn't matter. Think of that moment. And when was it? What happened? What happened before that? And what happened after that moment? Then you get a story. So from that moment on, when people realize that they have told a story, because then I tell them, that's a story, because here's a beginning, there's a middle, a transformation, some change, happiness, sadness, anger, I don't know, and it has an ending. So then it's suddenly a story. But you remember an event, a certain thing, but always something going, there's always something in front and at the end as well. So then you have the arc, so to say. And when I ask for the arc moment, it's easier to go back and go forth from that as well.
Well, Peter, I wanted to let the audience ask you a couple of questions as well. We got one question. How do you handle people that are afraid of society?
Ooh. Well, my question would be to ask first, why are you afraid? Can you tell me a situation where you were afraid? And I think maybe it's only one situation, maybe it's many situations, but then you can always ask, why is it that it made you afraid? And where does it come from? Does it remind you of something when you were a child or whatever? So you can go back and look for the causes of fear, so to say.
So you want to address the root of the problem?
Yeah, I would say so, yeah. But I'm not a psychiatrist.
No, yes? But so it's always great to give advice to people, because when you see a certain situation in front of you, you never really know how to address it. So you look for elsewhere for other examples to really handle that situation.
Mm. Yeah, it's when somebody is afraid, there has always have to be a story of that fear in a way. So, because fear is an emotion. And so and fear has its origins somewhere in something that happened before. And you've learned to be afraid of something. So when you find out about that and about other moments, you might find out that there's maybe a kind of a dominant story in a people's, in a person's mind about being afraid of this or that.
Yeah. Well, we have another question. How important is emotion in storytelling?
I think it's very important because a story evokes emotions as well. I mean, you become engaged in a story. You feel empathy for a protagonist. I mean, if a good storyteller tells the story well, you start to feel with the protagonist of the story. So the emotion is already there. So when something happens to him, you are sad for him or you are afraid for him. So you, in a way, you transport your emotions to the protagonist and vice versa. What happens to him touches you. And that emotions, of course, are very much involved.
Right.
It's also like an emotion like fear. Oh, what's going to happen to him now? Yeah.
Actually, I had a question now that I thought about it. Is that when you mention storytelling, you talk a lot about how you tell a story that you experience yourself. Mm. How would you handle telling a story of someone else? Because when I think of telling that story, I want it to be as authentic as possible because I don't want to misconstrue any information. How would you handle that?
A third person story.
Yeah, of course.
Story. Yeah. But that has to do, I think, with empathy. How can you feel into another person's feelings, in a way? Mm. You have to have experienced these feelings, of course, yourself first. And then you can, how can I say that? What's the good word? Transfer it
right
to the third person in a way. Because you know how it feels to be this or that. And in that you can also put these feelings into that third person as well. But others, it's all to do with empathy in a way.
Right.
How can you feel into another person's feelings or emotions? Feelings is a bit strange because there's a difference between emotions and feelings. Because feelings are very idiosyncratic and very difficult to describe, but the emotion is what you see and what you try to understand. And if you're good in understanding other people's emotions, if you can, let's say, feel with them in a way, in your way, then you can transfer it to different actors in the story.
I've got another question, and please ask your questions away. How do you use your storytelling skills in real life?
Well, I don't know if I use my storytelling skills in real life very well. I don't know. I think when I explain something, I always try to give an example of something. So I might use in metaphors quite a lot. Because it helps, it's easier to understand for people when you tell something in a way that they also understand. When it's complex, becoming complex, you can always say, well, think of it as this or that. So this is a kind of storytelling technique that you can implement as well. I think it's sometimes difficult. I find it difficult sometimes to get myself stopping a story when
right.
I'm telling a
yeah.
story, yeah. And I try to be aware of that, that it has to come to an end.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, it becomes a rant, you know, like which is not really interesting. Mm. Yeah.
I find myself sometimes when I'm telling stories that I get myself cut off, either because they weren't listening in the first place or because I guess they got bored, which is a bit harsh, but.
Mm-hmm.
That's the word I would use. But how would you go about it? Would you address the cut, or would you just move on from the story entirely?
I think what you just said is that's the thing. Is observing the listener when you tell the story, because the non-verbal communication will be, oh, he might be bored. If you remember, we had this little exercise when we had the course, when you start looking away or looking down or doing other things while the other one is telling a story. As a teller, you should, let's say, listen with your eyes what your audience or your listener is doing while you tell the story. And if you see that somebody's turning away a lot, say, am I boring you? You can ask him, am I boring you? Okay. Or is it not interesting what I'm telling? Or shall I move on?
Yeah.
So there has to be this dialogue as well. But that goes also for the listener, because, I mean, telling a story is a present you give to another person, but listening back is also a present you give to the teller.
That's a very interesting advice for people who are afraid of telling their story. But in any case, thank you for being on the show, Peter. We're now going to move on to the film challenge, which was also performed by the SAE students. And the one presenting it will be my colleague and co-presenter, Tess van Dijvenbode.
Hello, everybody. So now we're just going to move on to the film challenge, which is something we did in advance of this film festival. It was a very difficult challenge. We all took part in it. We had some rules. All the films had to be made within 7 days, and each team got a genre, a prop, and a color they had to include in their film. And we had three teams. The first team was led by Kyle as a line producer and Helena Kulitsky as our post producer. The second team was led by Kritika as a line producer. She's here today as well. And Leia, our post-producer. And team three was led by Burley, who was a line producer. And Rajbir, the presenter who was before me, he was the overall executive producer of this challenge. So team one, they had a set of requirements they had to use. They had the color red, which they had to introduce in their story. They had a prop of a hairpin, and their genre was drama. So let's have a look at Team One's film. It's called What If I Didn't?
Sure, I unplug it. I always unplug it.
Perfect.
Putting the lid on the milk.
Oh, that's explained.
I'm sure I unplugged it. I always unplug it.
Okay, cup is in the sink. Cup is always in the sink, that's where it's meant to be. Cup is always in the sink before it goes into the dishwasher. Okay.
James, are you okay, honey?
Mom, it's happening again.
Okay, it's okay. Breathe. You're okay. Everything is where it should. Talk to me. I'm here. Talk to me.
Okay.
It's okay.
It's okay.
Welcome. So we hoped you liked that film. What if I didn't? I'm going to invite the line producer, Kyle, on now. Welcome, Kyle.
Thank you very much for having me.
So you were the line producer for Team One.
Yeah.
What was it like being line producer in COVID times?
Yeah, it was really difficult because, yeah, you're not in person. And I feel like when you're messaging people on WhatsApp, people feel like, well, you don't have to reply and like, oh, yeah, you can... People don't know how busy you actually are, so getting people to do things was a lot more of a mission because there's no real, we're not at uni anymore, so can't tell them, oh, what's been happening, and trying to get a hold of people is a bit difficult, but we managed, and yeah, that was the result, so
yeah
happy
of course,
with it.
It's only 7 days.
Yeah.
It's not much, is it, to make a film?
It was, major crunch time at the end, so yeah.
Yeah. And why do you think it was the right choice to make a film on this topic?
Well, I feel like a lot of people have their certain things that they worry about. And for some, it's not something that they can be at peace with. It's always rising up and they're always concerned about something which, you know, doesn't allow them to actually enjoy the good in life. And it's always... Yeah, they're always worrying about something, and that's never nice to have that thing in the back of your head, like that voice telling you, oh, you have to do this, you have to do that. And I mean, yeah, I mean, I have that, but definitely not on the level of, like, the film, but, you know, worrying about things, and, you know, it's a terrible feeling having missed something. So if you're constantly worrying about things all the time, like, yeah. So I thought it's great to show that through a film, and... how some people, and also towards the end where, you know, he's being calmed down, and it's also just to show people that, yeah, be there for your friends if you know that they struggle with things, and it's not nice being alone and struggling.
Mm-hmm. And how difficult was it for you to use your attribute in the film, the hairpin?
Oh, well, not that difficult. I mean, Yeah, since he already is worried about everything, you know, when it gets to a more serious standard, I guess he could start making things up in his head. And then, yeah, it's just concerned for his own safety as well. With being the door being locked and everything. So I thought, yeah, it was quite easy because the hairpins are always associated with like picking locks and things. So mm-hmm. with the whole double checking locks, it worked perfectly actually.
Yeah, so it really was the obvious way to use it.
Yeah.
Okay, if you have any questions at home, please send them in through the chat. We already have one. How did you come up with the way you used the red color?
Well, red is often associated with drama, I would say. Not, it tends to be due to like bloodshed, but with us it was more like an alert, like being worried, and it's quite a strong color, so it was quite easy to show the audience like how his stages of thoughts is escalating or diminishing, and you can go on that like journey with him.
Mm-hmm. And were there any problems in the planning due to the 7-day limit?
Well, getting everything organized, yeah, was quite tricky. But eventually everything did, it didn't go 100% smoothly. Nothing always stays to plan. But with the shoot days that we had, I thought maybe we'd need a third one. But it's always that first shoot day that's a bit, everyone's figuring out what needs to be done. Not everyone has the same vision of the script. Everyone perceives it like when a couple of people read the same book, they're all going to have a different perspective. And that's why book clubs exist, for example. So it's, the film's also a good talking point as well. But I'm glad that everyone did contribute and was there because it turned out to be a great film, much better than I expected, to be honest. But couldn't have asked for a better team.
Okay, that's great to hear. Next up, we're going to see Team 2's film. They had the color white, their genre was action, and their prop was a wooden box. Let's see how they used that in their film, What Bad Things Happen. Sorry.
Guys, have you ever been skydiving?
Oh no, that would stress me out too
much. No way, it's like a once in a lifetime experience.
No, I'm telling you, there is no way you could convince Kara to do something that risky.
Really? It's true, you guys. I don't even step on cracks. I don't need that bad.
Okay, of course. The bad juju.
I'm just saying, enough bad things are happening in the world. Why would I risk my life jumping out of a tin can in the sky?
Oh, but like, I totally get it, but did I ever tell you about a story that I went to Bulgaria with my friend. And like, when the guy crossed the door, like, he sighed really because the plane, the plane was more octane, so I think it was more octane than actual plane. They're like, I'm telling you, when the guy actually closed the door, he sighed.
Sorry, what?
You zoomed out for a minute.
Sorry, I get distracted easily. I'll give us some wine.
A new boyfriend, but he's nice, right?
Yeah, lovely.
So how about you stop stressing out. It's kind of difficult for her, I guess. Just join in the conversation. You're being a shitty host right now. Who invites people over and just runs away from the table?
Yo! Charlie! Baby! Baby! What's going on?
Seriously, babe. If there's anything I can do to help, just tell me.
Thanks, babe. You know, I just need to get my head straight.
Yeah? You sure?
Yeah.
Okay.
You bring the wine and I'll get the glasses.
Okay.
Just have fun without me. I'm going to bed in any case. Yeah. Love you. Charlie, is that you?
That you can rewatch this stream after we finished. It's going to be saved on our Twitch channel, so just go to our profile and you can watch it all back and enjoy it endlessly. So now I'm going to interview the line producer of Team 2, Kritika.
Hi.
Welcome. How nice to have you. So, what were the challenges of the 7-day film challenge for your team?
There were quite a few challenges, especially with the time that we only had 7 days to write a script, shoot it, and do all the post-production. And with the themes, to incorporate those themes in the film and make it as effective as possible for the crew and for the audience that will be watching this and for everybody that's going through anxiety. That was our theme for the for this film.
Mm-hmm. And was it difficult for you to use the color? You had, I think, the most difficult color, white.
white is probably the simplest, and that makes it the hardest color to incorporate in the film, or anything really. But we used it as the main prop, the wooden box. We painted it white, and the wooden box basically represents the white color, that's the innocence, but then it's tainted with red and blood, and that's how we brought out the action part of the film.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, speaking of the action part, how long did it take for you to film the coughing scene?
The coughing scene took really long, mostly because we had to take different angles of her, our main character Kara for her coughing. And she had to cough a lot. So it took probably 5 to 7 scenes and probably like 30 to 40 minutes to film just the coughing scene.
Oh, poor girl. Yeah. So if you have any questions as well at home for Kritika, we'd love to hear them. We have one question here. Is there anything you would have done differently about this production?
Differently? Probably with time and incorporating the color white more, just not with the box, but a little bit more. But that's probably it. I think the film came out pretty well, and the writer was great, and the script was written really well. So that made the film just shine.
Mm-hmm. And what did you film with? Do you remember?
Yeah, we filmed with Blackmagic, and yeah, it's working with Blackmagic was amazing, and we got some incredible shots because of that, and as you can see from the film that you can rewatch.
Yeah. Oh, that's great to hear. Did you have any problems getting a crew together? Or did you already have some people in mind beforehand?
We had a few people in mind, and some people pitched in for the film, and yeah, the people, our crew was really friendly, and we had an amazing amazing brainstorming session before starting the film. Mm-hmm. And yeah, we all had great ideas and great way to incorporate everyone's ideas together. So that was great, working with an amazing team.
Yeah, and was it easy to reach them? Kyle mentioned there were some problems due to the COVID thing.
It was kind of hard, but because, I don't know, my team was pretty active and they were really passionate about this theme, and because the main character Kara, the actress for it, Joya, she wanted to do the theme of anxiety, so she was really passionate about the idea, the whole idea, so she really put in a lot of work, and everybody just pitched in really well.
Mm-hmm. And why do you think it was this story of anxiety really had to be told?
I feel like anxiety is something that is very widely spread, like a disorder that's really well known, but also people don't know what it is to go through it. So showing it from a perspective that of someone who's going through it can spread awareness, especially, and you can really see how it affects a person and their mind.
Mm-hmm. And was the dream sequence always the main idea?
Dream sequence, yes, because I think from the dream sequence and zoning out of the character, you can really see what is going through in their heads and what mm-hmm. they're going through in their minds, and how they're showing themselves outside. So the people with anxiety who don't even know if they have anxiety can really relate and can really relate to the film and feel comforted that there are a lot of people who are going through this, and you can always reach out.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.
All right. So now we're going to watch the third team, the last team's film. So they had the color blue to work with. Their genre was thriller horror, and their prop was an alarm clock. So let's have a look at team three, led by line producer Burley. Let's see their film. It's called Even.
Thank you. Nadia.
Hi, guys. Hey. Good to see you.
Where can the shoes?
Oh, you can leave them on. It's okay.
Okay.
And the masks? What you prefer. You can go sit in the living room. I will come.
Oh, you look good, by the way.
Thank you.
Better than last time. A little bit less pixelated. Where can I put my coat?
Wherever you want.
Okay.
Do you want something to drink?
Yeah, water is good.
Lemonade.
Yeah.
Lemonade.
Yes, thank you.
You're welcome.
So, expecting someone else?
No, I'm just thirsty.
So, have you still been looking for a job?
Yes.
And how's it going? Did you find something?
I'm trying, but nobody seems interested in an intern without experience.
For me?
Where is
your toilet? I kind of need to powder my nose.
Oh, it's over there.
So where have you been looking?
I would like to work at the ING.
Oh, okay, that's really good.
Yeah.
But there's no type of bank that's looking for an intern?
At least, not remote.
And how about non-remote?
I'm not going outside. If I get it, I'm done. You know better than anyone how it is with my immune system.
Yeah, sure, I understand, but I mean, some jobs take really good measures.
I'm not going outside.
Well, I mean, you cannot stop your whole life for this.
I'm not going.
If you want to, of course, I could always help you with finding a job.
Serieus in de rood.
Ja, super OCD. Moet je kijken. Wat is twee? Oh.
Hey.
Hi. So, Anna, your mom called me actually.
Oh, that's so sweet of her. She's so sweet.
Yeah, it was
that's
really,
kind.
Really sweet.
She's actually kind of worried about you. So are we, by the way.
Oh, but you don't need to be.
She was more just concerned, and you know, she informed me that she was actually
Anya, you need to talk to us, okay? Like, this is not normal, right?
But I'm okay, so you don't have to worry.
What was you doing? Were you washing your hands?
Yeah, I just want to say that if there's anything on your mind or...
You have to tell us.
Please talk to me. You know I'm always here for you.
I will, but I'm okay, so I don't have to tell anything.
Oh, okay. Well, I really hope you are, actually. Because I'm concerned as well.
Anya, I mean, come on.
You said you were thirsty, but you haven't even touched your drinks. This is bullshit.
Yeah, but
no.
That's for later this night.
Nah.
Leave it there,
you know,
right? This is my house, right?
You know why your mother called us? Mother called us because you called her 4 times, okay? 4 times.
Because
that's
I'm worried
normal.
About her, right? She lives in another country.
4 times in 2 minutes?
Yeah, your mother lives in the same country as you, right?
You.
Tom, please.
Leave it! Let's hear.
We gaan niet weg! We gaan niet aan nog langer deze onzin verkopen!
I'm so sorry for what just happened. You know, we really just want you to do well, so... Just please take a deep breath in and take a deep breath out. Maybe you can just calm down, it will be okay.
Nee, maar dit komt op het toilet, naast de andere twee.
Ja.
Net zoals ze 2 letters heeft, net zoals 2 limonade, 2 keer water, voor alles 2. Weet je?
Het
enige wat ze niet 2 keer heeft, is dat verdomme running, dat altijd de hele tijd afgaat.
Maar we zijn toch ook juist hier om haar te helpen?
Ze wil niet geholpen worden, toch?
Ik snap het toch, alsjeblieft, heel rustig. Het komt goed. Kijk nou, als wij juist
ruzie
met haar gaan.
Ja, wat wil je dan van, hè? Wat wil je dat ik doe?
Gewoon juist
kalmeren, zodat
we kunnen
kijken naar zo'n oplossing. Je heeft een psychiater nodig, niet...
Welcome back! We hope you enjoyed the third film, Even, by Team 3. We have with us here the editor, David. Welcome! Thank you for joining us. So, tell me, what was it like to edit a film like this?
It was actually really interesting. I have never edited a film with such a heavy topic before. And I have to give it hands down to the writer and the director. They gave me amazing insight on just exactly what they wanted. So it was extremely easy to edit, and it was a real pleasure working with them.
Oh, that's great to hear. How far were you involved with the whole project? Were you in from day one?
On day one, I gave some creative insights about how we could interpret the color blue in the film. So I suggested at the start we start with a little tint, and as slowly as we progress throughout the film, we tint the screen bluer and bluer and bluer until at the end it's like we were in a smart village.
Right, and how much time did they give you to edit the film?
They gave me 2 days. I edited everything in around 7 hours.
Oh,
so.
Right. Do you think that you would have liked more time?
It was definitely rushed a bit. We had 7 days to film everything, so I had a couple of hours to spare, but since I did everything in 7 hours, it was fine.
Okay. Someone also asked why the line producer was not interviewed. That's because she had to leave early, but we have... great substitute right here. So, what was your favorite aspect of the film?
Definitely the implementation of the color, because we got lucky because we got blue, because blue gave us that cold and unappealing feeling, because our main protagonist has OCD, and throughout the film, it just her panic attack gets worse and worse and worse, so the color blue really represents well.
And was it hard for you to put the genre thriller horror into this film?
It was definitely a challenge, but after watching some online tutorials and just talking with the producer and writer, everything went smooth.
Okay, that's great to hear. If you have any other questions, of course, you're welcome to ask them. We'll get them straight to David. We have an interesting question right here. Would you have made any changes to the film if you'd been the director?
I would definitely have shot with a slightly better camera, because when I received the footage, it was slightly on the wrong color temperature. So, oh yeah, I would have shot with a different camera. I would have shot a few things slightly differently, but that's it. Otherwise, they did an amazing job.
Mm-hmm. Can you give any examples of scenes?
For example, there was one scene when they filmed from way too low and they panned the camera up, and it just didn't work in the scene. So that I would probably do like an over-the-shoulder shot or something when it's like level with the character's eyes.
Okay, interesting. Let's see what else we have. Did you have any influence on how the story was told?
No, not really. The writer did, again, as I say, an amazing job, so I didn't need to do anything.
Okay, that's great. Do you think you'd like to work on more films in the future on the topic of mental health?
Definitely. This was really interesting to film, so yeah, I would be definitely down to do another one.
And what kind of mental health topic would you choose?
I would probably choose anxiety, because that's something a lot of people deal with these days, especially in COVID days. So I would definitely put out a film which spreads awareness for anxiety.
Mm-hmm. Another question is, would you have done a different story if you were a line producer?
I don't think so. It was a pretty good story, and I'm more of a camera behind the scenes operator.
Okay.
So I'm not kind of a story writer. So.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. Yeah, is there anything else you'd like to add about the challenges of doing it all within 7 days?
It was definitely tough and also interesting, but it kind of showed like how much we can do in such a short time period. So it brought us like some of the best ideas, because we had a short time period for filming and editing. We were like, okay, we don't have time to do this, but we can do this, which will look even better. So it was definitely very interesting.
Ah, that's great. Yeah. And do you think you could maybe make more out of this film? Maybe make it longer?
Yeah, I could definitely develop it, make it a bit longer and looking a bit, well, prettier. But yeah, I think I could develop it into a like full feature evening film.
Okay. Interesting. Do you have any tips for other editors out there?
Watch YouTube tutorials. Honestly, that's the best platform to learn everything. Like 90% of what I know, I learned from YouTube.
Okay. And what kind of editing software do you use?
I use Adobe Premiere Pro.
And have you worked with any others?
I worked like in the early days of editing when I was like 11, 12. I worked with Camtasia Studio, which was a free software I found online. And then when I was 13, I switched to Premiere Pro, and I've been using it ever since.
Oh, okay. Yeah, because in school we also have to learn how to edit with Final Cut,
yeah.
Which I'm sure will be a drastic change, but I'm sure you're up for it.
Mm.
All right. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, it was great to hear from the technical side as well of this film. So now we have a little compilation of the behind the scenes of what happened during the 7-day challenge.
Action. Jesus.
Okay, next thing he's opening the door.
Is that traffic?
Yeah.
Lars?
Yeah.
Maxine? Robert?
No, we're gonna do one from here, yeah.
Okay.
I'm gonna go down.
Yeah.
Back. I'm back. I hope you enjoyed the compilation, of course. I'm gonna announce, I'm not gonna announce, but please do vote for the audience award, because that will also be presented at the end of the stream. Today I've got my lovely jury members here, Peter Fruman, Malik Bouaziz, and Inigo Viuget. I'm sorry if I mispronounce any of them.
No, I see.
I'm also want to take the time to thank our sponsors, SAE. I want to thank our location, Rewind Studios. They were lovely enough to give us this place. And I also want to thank Sam Cartier, who provided us with the music for this festival. So, jury members, could you announce the winner of Best Film?
Well, I think since... after a very difficult and a very intense sharing of ideas and opinions, we are gonna go for the movie What If I Didn't for best film of the challenge. We really enjoyed the editing and the emotion that the film basically made us feel. It was a very powerful, and I think the editing was very well achieved. I think the level of the sound design and Foley included in the movie was, for me, from a sound engineering point of view, very well achieved. And yeah, that was one of the main reasons also why we chose this movie as a best film.
Okay. Well, Team One's line producer, Kyle, if you can come on stage and retrieve your trophy.
Thank you very much. Well done. Thank you. Thank you for voting.
And thank you for
You're welcome. So now that it has been revealed, do you have any advice or any criticism you would give to the line producer or any of the crew of What If I Didn't?
I don't know if any of my colleagues also would like to add something after me, but from a sound engineer point of view, like I said before, I really enjoy the fact that there was an extra care for the sound for in the movie, and I think that it is one of the most important. It is one of the most important things when we make movies. If you have, I think, very. If you think about sound when you are making the movie, then I think the emotion and the feeling that you can provoke afterwards is very, very rewarding, and it makes you much more immersed into the movie itself. And I think What If I Didn't was one of the best ones in this case. And so yeah, guys, don't forget, sound is one of the most important things always for your movies.
Of course, you can you guys can also ask your questions in the chat below, and of course I want to address the sort of elephant in the room. No, we did not rig this. They chose the winners. I had nothing to do with it.
You sure?
You're going to have to trust me.
Yes.
But Peter, as you are our storytelling professor. do you have anything to say about the storytelling in the movie?
Yeah, well, look, I'm not a filmer. I'm not a professional filmer. So I was looking at the films from the storytelling aspect, from what happens. And does it engage me? Does it amuse me, entertain me? Does it make me emphasize? And does it make me curious? So that's why I was going for this one, in a way, as the best, because there was no distraction from the protagonist, so it was easy for me to empathize with him and his feelings or his emotions, in a way. And I think it built up nicely. Not so much a story arc, in a way, but anyway, it built to something. And in the end, I was really, well, I was taken by his choice of asking for help. And it was mum, so that was really endearing, surprising, but it was endearing in a way, so satisfying for me to watch it. And, well, and as I think Kyle said in his interview about the color red,
yep.
Of course it's a signal color, it's a color of danger maybe, well, that was obvious, of course, because when the mood changed, the color changed, so that was very obvious. But I didn't care because I could follow it nicely. It took me on a journey.
Mm. Well, again, if you've got any questions, you can still ask them. Malik, you're kind of our wild card judge in this case. Do you have anything to say to the crew of What If I Didn't?
I was really enthusiastic when I saw that it was the first year student and second year student who were working all together for a really good result. I have to admit that I hesitated for giving the first prize to What If I Didn't, because the other ones were also pretty good. But again, congratulations to all of you because you did a really good job, and it's not because you are the host that you are.
No. Thank you. Of course, Malik, being a working with SAE, you are, if you could reveal your position.
And the academic coordinator.
The academic coordinator. Well, thank you guys for that result. Now I would like to go to the award of Best Use of Color. If any of you could reveal the winner.
You too. Yeah, you too.
Yeah, let's do it again.
Do it again, okay. Do we have any kind of drum roll or something like that? And the movie for... No. And the winner, I think, for... Well, I don't think I know. For Best Use of Color is Bad Things Happen.
Well, congratulations to Bad Things Happen. Kritika, can you come on stage, please?
Me again.
Yes.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Okay. Well done.
Thank you. Thank you.
Well done.
Congratulations, Kritika and her team.
Thank you.
Congratulations to Team 2. I hope Actually, I hope you guys in the chat enjoyed the movie as well. Of course, I'm going to go back to Inigo. Any criticism for the team?
Probably one of the things that struck me the most about this movie was the good level of acting. It was very well achieved, and it really kept me very attached and interested in what was happening in the movie throughout the whole film. Probably, knowing some of the people who actually participated in it, I would have appreciated maybe a bigger and much more curated level of audio in terms of the quality. Sometimes it was a little bit complicated to follow what the main actress was saying or what was happening in it. But overall, I thought it was a very well achieved film. I really enjoyed the action part of the movie, and overall, I really, really enjoyed it, especially the way they used the white for like adding that kind of anxious feeling towards the film. I think it was very well achieved. Mm.
Peter, I'm going to go back to you, storytelling-wise.
Storytelling-wise, I have to follow the other speaker in a way that I couldn't really understand. Some dialogues were difficult, a little bit difficult for me to understand. So in a way, I couldn't follow the conversation very well enough. I'd really to listen carefully. So that distracted a little bit. But from, let's say, the dramatic content, I think it was done very well. It was really built up well, and for me it was a kind of a hidden aggression in the person that was... So in that way it was nice. Also the ending was intriguing,
mm-hmm.
and well done.
Malik, of course, Team 2's color being white. What do you think of it? How of the way that it was presented in the movie?
First of all, I don't think white is a color. Just for you to know. But it was really interesting, especially at the end with the red versus the white, with the action after the action scene, which was pretty good. On this, I would say I don't like cuts. So I'm more John Wick, so when you have to punch, you punch for real. But it was a really good scene. I also appreciated the fact that the camera for the first part of the movie was not always changing, only one view, one fixed camera. It was pretty nice for me as a viewer to follow it.
Mm-hmm.
And I could see the color white everywhere. And also congratulations to the actress, Joaya, who did really a good job. Because I'm sure it was not easy for her.
I actually had a question for all of you.
Mm-hmm.
What did you think about all of the movies so far? Because they do have kind of the similar topic. What do you think that says to you about the crew members themselves, about how they think about mental health issues?
They see it maybe linked to the loneliness. If you stay at home too long, you become crazy.
Yeah.
This is more or less what I've noticed. And also it ends up with paranoia, narcolepsy. And also the last one was obsessive compulsive disorder.
I think it's important, you know, at the end of the day, these kind of issues are being addressed, and that the vision that all the different crews have towards these kind of illnesses. And I think that you guys did a great job addressing it, and the way you did it, it's very well achieved. I am really proud also, because I mean, I have most of you as students as well, and it's really nice to see how can you guys express these kind of emotions and these kind of feelings and situations that are happening. I think nowadays, with everything that is going on, it's probably maybe a little bit accentuated. And so I think you guys did an amazing job with it, and just keep on working on it.
Right. Malik, what would you like to see for the students that made these movies? What would you like to see in the future? Do you have anything that, any advice you would want to give them?
Consistency, in a sense that the last movie was pretty good in the term of history, but the editing, I'm sorry, the editing could be more consistent in the sense that we had several scenes that were shot in a way that you could follow. You had good ideas, but they were not completed, they were not fulfilled, they were not taken to the end. And also, I like the last movie because it has been shot with an iPhone, as far as I understand,
mm-hmm.
which is a good idea. And maybe at the end they were running out of budget because we didn't see the dead bodies.
Right. Peter.
Yeah.
Any advice for any up and coming filmmakers or storytellers, actually?
Well, it's well, when I come back to the last film, which I think was the idea was very intriguing and interesting, but it all in a way lose elements that I couldn't really combine. I had some question marks here and there,
mm-hmm.
so it could also have been that she had really a multiple disorder, but also a disorder like imaginary friends,
correct.
Things like that. You know,
yeah. mm-hmm.
but I didn't. That was just. After I heard that the theme was mental health. Mm-hmm. So the first time I watched it without any information, I didn't get it. Mm-hmm. Afterwards, I thought, oh, I could have got it. Maybe it was, and so on. So then the intention of the story didn't make me interpret it in the right way. So I couldn't interpret the intention of the story told. So what was it really about? Because that's what you want. In the end, at the end of a story, you want to have a kind of a event, you know, like, that's what it was about. And I've learned something, or I can go home happily because all pieces came together, you know, the puzzle came together in a way. So this is where, I think it's important that you have also put an ending to it, unless you want a story with an open ending because you want to film another episode.
Right.
Yeah. So,
all right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I just received the results of the audience awards. Now, the team, can I get a drum roll actually?
Oh, yeah.
The team that won the audience award is Team 2. Congratulations to Kritika and her team. Bad things happen. For this one, I'm going to be the one that's giving it. So I'm going to have some participation.
Yes.
Congratulations,
Kritika.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is going to be it for the stream. Thank you for participating. I would actually want to have the presenters come on set because I can't do this alone. I've had these two
yep.
by my side.
All right.
Come over here. Or stand behind the couch, actually.
Yeah.
Thank you for watching. And I hope you enjoyed the film festival, first of all. If you only joined just now, I'm sorry. You can rewatch the stream, of course, as we mentioned ad nauseum during the stream. Anything you guys wanted to say?
Yeah, thank you all for watching. We really enjoyed making this. We really thank our judges for coming. And also for being our guests, and for everyone who helped behind the scenes. Just, it was a great experience. Thank you all very much.
Yeah. And thank you to SAE as well for helping us out to make this possible.
Yeah, and to Rewind Studios for giving us this great location to do it at.
And also thank you to Sam Cartier. If you're watching the stream, your music was really good. We thought you were very talented.
Yes.
Yeah, so,
thank you.
Thank you, I guess. Thank you to our judges for appearing. Thank you for Peter
to
guest on our show.
Thank you.
Thank
you for having us.
And thank you to Maaike, who coordinated all this film, the whole film. Well, ladies and gentlemen, the stream is going to end. Thank you very much for joining us, and goodbye.